everyone, my name is Kameron. Today we're back at another book review. I was just here like 5 minutes ago, so we're doing another one. We did Set for Life last time, and this time we're starting on The Richest Man in Babylon. So like I said, we're doing, this is going to be kind of the second version, but still the same story, but it's going to be a little bit more clear when I tell it to you. It's a little confusing to find the first page, right? The man who desired gold. Bansur, the chariot builder of Babylon, was thoroughly discouraged because from his place, he had a really low wall, signing his poverty, and he gazed sadly at his simple home and open workshop that he had with one partially completed chariot in there. And his wife frequently appeared at the open door. Her furtive glances in his direction reminded him that the meal bag was almost empty and that he should be at work pushing the chariot. So this means he has to build chariots to make money for food for the family. So hammering and hewing, polishing and painting, stretching the taut and the leather over the wheel rims and preparing for delivery so he could collect from his wealthy customer. Because, of course, they're really expensive. Nevertheless, his fat, muscular body sat stolidly upon the wall. His slow mind was struggling patiently with a problem for which he could find no answer. But can you just make, go closer? I'm about to yell. The hot tropical sun was very merciless because it was really hot where he was. And let's skip through some stuff. Beyond his house was the high walls surrounding the king's palace, and all of this stuff that made him look kind of sad because his house is really sad. And he turned over to see some slave carriers getting some goat skins and water to pour on plants, I think. And he turned around and looked at his best friend, Kobe, the musician. May the gods bless thee with great liberty, my good friend. So they were his really close friends, and they're both working paycheck to paycheck in a way, but not really like gold to gold, I guess. So. If I did have 2 shekels, Mansur responded, to no one would I lend them, not even to you, my best friends, for they would be for my fortune, my entire fortune. So by the way, he is really poor. 2 shekels, I think, would probably be, I guess, their currency. I'm not sure how much that would transfer to our money. I don't really know. Probably not that much. Most of the time it's having me to summarize about it. So
read out loud.
But do you want me to just read it out?
No, I want you to book review, not reading.
I know, I'm looking through it, looking for a part.
Yeah.
It began, I'm gonna read through this part because it's really important. It began with a dream. A senseless dream. By the way, Bansur is a word of his perspective, and then Kobe is the musician who's also his best friend. It began with a dream, a senseless dream in which I thought I was a man of means. From my belt hung a handsome purse, heavy with coins. There were shekels, which I cast with careless freedom to the beggars. There were pieces of silver, which I... Dude, keep it down! Pieces of silver, which I did buy finery for my wife and whatever I did desire for himself. There are pieces of gold, which made me feel assured of the future and unafraid to spend the silver. A glorious feeling of contentment was within me. You would not have known me for thy hardworking friend, nor would he have known his wife, so free from wrinkles that his face was shining with happiness. And all of those happiness stuff. A pleasant dream indeed, commented Kobe, but why would kind of dream like that? So, Then he showed him, like, can you borrow some shekels, and he showed his purse, which is completely empty. And what to eat is sour goat milk in porridge. So, I'm going to skip to some of the important stuff. This very day suggested Kobe, I did pass by our old friend, Arkad, riding his golden chariot. Arkad is mostly kind of the main character in a way, but not really. Well, he's one of their good friends, and he's very, 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 very rich. So I'm going to explain how rich he is later. So, very wealthy, actually. So he's kind of made it, and I'm not sure why. I mean, Arkad, he doesn't give to his friends, but later he's going to give some advice. Because, of course, Arkad has enough money to make them very rich, of course. So, hey, come on, he has a golden chariot. It's made out of pure gold. So, this I will say, he did not look over his humble head. And instead, he did wave his hand and all that stuff. He's claimed to be the richest man in all of Babylon. Of course, we know, right? Richest man in Babylon, and having Arkad, so it's going to be on him. I'm assuming he's the main character, because that's the shipping title. Gordon aids in Pharaoh's treasury. So, they're just talking about how rich he is, and like, whoa, it's kind of wowing at him. And then they started talking about going to Arkad, I know one of them said something. I remember.
That's why mommy said use the highlighter.
I know. I had the highlighter.
You had to get into that.
But one of them said that they wanted to steal from him because how rich he is. But then, Bouncer said he wanted to steal from Arkad. But Kobe said that even if he stole from him, it wouldn't mean much because somehow he has enough money, enough income to flow into his purse so that he can replace what's gone. Because that's how he makes enough money to spend.
Mm-hmm.
Actually, like, if you drink some water, you'll just lose it back. Or, I don't know, eat money or something, but. And he said, Kobe, Dosh brings me, this one, by the way, there is no change vocabulary in this.
Oh, okay.
There is no change vocabulary. I have to kind of just think about it more. Kobe, thou shalt bringest me to me a word of thought. A new light being in Bouncer's eyes. It costs nothing to ask wise advice from a good friend, Arkad was always that. So they want to ask him for some advice. Next chapter, this man Babylon. And that's his name in the chapter. He was really rich. He was wise in his charities, generous in those, generous to his family, and he was famous for his wealth. That's pretty nice, I guess. And he always spent a lot of money, but he earned more than he could spend. So, that's kind of financial freedom, I guess. Alright, let's get started. You, Arkad, are more fortunate than we. You have become the richest man in all Babylon while we struggle for existence. You can wear the finest garments, and you can enjoy the worst, but one must be content while we clothe our families in raiment that is presentable and feed them the best we can. Yet once we're equal, we study under the same master, play the same games, and neither the studies nor the games outshine us. And since the years, you have been no more of honorable citizens this week. I mean, we are equal, but how did you get better than us? So, and he said, alright, then he said this. Nor have you worked harder or more faithfully, then why should a fickle fate single you out to enjoy all the good things in life? And yours were equally deserving. Why are the gods blessing you? I'm at Babylon, so they have gods there. And why are you being blessed? Why are you so lucky? Like, why are you so rich? And we did all that you did. Not really. We work as hard as you do. But how are you just so rich? Arkad saying, if you have not acquired more than a bare existence, then since you are used this, because you've either not observed them. Fickle fate is a vicious goddess who brings no permanent good to anyone. On the contrary, she brings almost ruin to every man who, upon showers, unearned gold, meaning if they steal or something, they torment them, I guess. I mean, there's no such thing as luck or someone that will favor you over another and try to make you as rich as you can. Like, God won't just give you $1,000,000 or $1,000,000,000 just because, I don't know, you do that. He doesn't just do random stuff, like random giveaways or anything. You have to just earn your own money, so. Yeah, talking about shish kebabs.
Go ahead, just talk.
Alright, just talking about wealth. Wealth is a power. With wealth, many things are possible.
Yeah, you
one may ornament the home with the rich furnishings, one may sell his sneakers, one may feast on the delicacies of foreign aid, or one may buy gold and ornaments from the gold workers and stone polishers. So, let's move on to when he started his farm. Being, as you know, a son of humble merchants of large family with no hope. By the way, merchants back then weren't considered rich. You think a salesman right now would be pretty wealthy? Wrong's done. Alright, so, by the way, merchants weren't that wealthy back then. They were considered average to poor. It's likely because, the way they did it, they were as smart as they were now. It's really hard, like they had to travel and they had to like hand make their own items then sell them. So like, if they're kind of a factory worker and a salesman combined, so they weren't considered very rich. So they had to kind of do both, or they would trade for goods. It just wasn't the ideal job back then. Like, nobody wanted to be their dream job as a merchant. They wanted to be, I don't know, a noble or something, but like, how would you get there? Back then, people didn't really know what they want, because I don't know what job they were, I don't know, stone polisher, but...
Just whoever they know, you know?
Mm. Yeah, they just do whatever, like, I don't know, what's short in this, I don't know why, I don't know how you got into chariot building. It's just so random, like, I don't know, I want to build chariots one day, so... Alright, now this is going to be where he is. And one day, Algamish, the money lender, came to the house of the city master and ordered a copy of the Ninth Law came to me. I must have this in 2 days, which has to demand at times 2 coppers I will give to thee. So he labored hard, but the law was long, and when Algamish returned, the task was unfinished. He was angry, and he was a slave. And had I been his slave, he would have beaten me. But knowing the city master would not permit him to injure me, he was afraid. And he was unafraid. So I said to him, Algamish, you're a very rich man. Tell me how I may also become rich. And all night I will carve upon the clay, and when the sun rises, it shall be completed. He smiled at him and replied, you are a foreign knave and require a bargain. I'm not sure what that means. So of course, I don't think it was that much of a change, but... okay. So he did something about his bargain. I'm not sure what that was. Mark you well my words, for if you do not, you will fail to grasp the truth I will tell you. You will think that your nights will have been in vain. Then he looked at him shrewdly from under his jagged brows and a low voice and said, I found a road to all wealth, and when I decided a part of all I earned was mine to keep. Then he said, is that all? I mean, Arkad, when he was a snake, said, is that all? And, but all I earned is mine to keep, is it not? He demanded, far from it. Do not pay the garment maker, do not pay the sandal maker, do not pay for things you eat. Meaning, not everything you make is for you to keep, because if you have to have expenses, it's not your money. It's, I don't know, the car dealership's money, or it's your landlord's money, or your, I don't know, the salesperson's money. It's not really yours. The only part of this for you to keep. Something you could build upon. Something that you could place into your network. Like, I already have some like piggy banks. Not really banks. Banks and piggy banks, not really. I don't know how to explain. I have a few piggy banks, a few regular bank accounts and all that, but piggy banks are rotten, like kind of rotting in a way. So it's not really that helpful anymore. But I kind of did set aside a small jar that would count as my net worth, like, you know, my actual worth. So right now it's not that much. I'm still working on it a bit. So yeah. Alright. Move on. So let's get to the part where they were talking. So after we talked about the part of all you earn is supposed to keep, part of what you earn is for you to keep. So after he went away, I've been taking his tablets. Tablets meaning I think like carvings or scripts. I thought much about it, so he said he would try it out. Each time he was paid from one of 10 pieces of copper, I think, he would take one and hide it away or save it. And after around, he managed to get along with it, but he was tempted to spend it for some good things the merchants displayed, bought by camels and ships from the land of the Phoenicians, but he refrained, meaning he stopped his spending. He became to be a little more frugal. And a 12-month later, Algamish come back and said, "Son, have you paid yourself not less than 1/10 of what you have earned for the past year?" I proudly answered, "Yes, master, I have." I need white water. "Good," he said. "So what have you done with that spending money?" "I've given it to Asmer, the brick maker. He told me he was traveling over the far seas in Tyre and would buy me for me the rare jewels of the Phoenicians. When he returns, we shall sell these at high prices and divide the earnings." Then, Ash, I don't know, I forgot his name. I'm gonna look for it. Algamish said, "Every fool must learn," he growled. "But why trust the knowledge of a brickmaker about jewels?" That's kind of true. Like, if you ask, I don't know, a construction worker how to get the best deal out of something, or for financial advice, you better ask a financial advisor, not a construction worker, because you only ask construction worker how to build a house or something. "Would you go to the bread maker to inquire about the stars?" "No, by my tunic you would go to the astrologer or the astronomers. If you had the power to think, your savings are gone, you've jerked your wealth tree up by the roots. But plant another. Try again next time you would go to. If you were to get advice about the jewels, go to the jeweler." So don't take advice from people who are unexperienced and all this stuff. And like you said, Asmor came back with worthless pieces of glass that look like gems. The Phoenician scammed him. Of course, the brickmaker like, "I would like some valuable gems." And the Phoenicians are like, "This dude's a brickmaker. We can fool him." Gave him some glass and scammed him. And of course, he's not going to come back to beat him up or anything, because it's expensive to sail the seas. So he did it again. It was no longer difficult because we can't have it. 12 months later, he came back and said, "What progress have you made?" "I paid myself faithfully," he said. "I entrusted Agar to show the maker to buy bronze, and each 4th month he paid me the rental." "That is good. What do you do with the rental?" "He had a great feast with honey and fine wine and spiced cake, meaning he just made a feast and a banquet." To which Algamish laughed, "You do eat the Trojanary savings, and how do you expect them to work for you?" He says, "Work for your money, and make money for them to work for you." He said, "First, you get an army of golden slaves and make a rich banquet, may you enjoy a pot of bread." Meaning, it's not available now because you can't get slaves now, of course. You have to actually, hire and pay. Slaves, workers, or employees, not the same thing. Workers are not really slaves, they're just really high paid. More than slaves. Slaves were like, I don't know, copper. For working, I had to give like 1,000 copper or something like that. But a copper would be, I don't know, a penny. you're going to have to give away more than 1,000 pennies. Mm-hmm. It's going to be very expensive.
Work that's more specialized.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, work that's more specialized. Slaves are more well-rounded. They weren't trained to do it, but they can do it if you force them. Alone. So, what you're saying is, you do eat your earnings. I mean, he didn't do anything wrong, but he could have done better. Like he said, instead hire an army of slaves to make the money and do the work for you. So of course, he said, okay, Babylon, I think they had a lot of slaves. I think slave was a sign of wealth, like that a few thousand years, no, like, I don't know. 3,000 or 4,000 years ago, slaves were very popular because free labor was very, everyone wanted that because they didn't want to work. And of course, it wasn't that good until a lot of stuff happened and it ended, but he not, again, did this for 2 years. When he came back, he was really old, full of deep green clothes and all that. Arkad, has thou ye, have, okay, it's still very confusing. Have you yet achieved the wealth you dreamed of? Answered, not yet of all that I desire, but some of it and earns more. And you still take the advice of brick makers. About brick making, they give good advice, he retorted. Arkad, you have learned the lessons well, and you learn to live upon less than you can earn, and actually learn how to make gold work for you. Mostly because you have to buy slaves, which cost gold. Now you have to make money that work for you, and you have to hire employees now. So. We're still really outdated, but it's still kind of, we could infer it to different things. And so he went to, yeah. Okay. So, that was kind of the story about Arkad, but not completely. So yeah, I think that sums up today's video. I got a little confused near the end.
Semis.
It was about Vansir in his chariot building. They came over to Arkad to ask for advice with his hobby, and he told him the story. Part of all you earn is for you to keep. So hope you guys enjoyed this video.